Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I'm going to be reviewing my favourite romance movie, as Valentine's Day is coming up very soon. I'm not usually a fan of romance, as I find the genre to be a bit cringy and cliché, unless we're talking about terrible romance movies. I find some entertainment value in those. But no, the subject of today's video is very well made and entertaining, and so, of course, I also had a lot of fun reviewing it as well. I hope you all enjoy the video as much as I enjoyed making it. So without further ado, on with the review. The Princess Bride was actually originally a book by William Goldman, a screenwriter probably most well known for the 1969 film Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Funnily enough, the screenplay for The Princess Bride was also written by Goldman, something I assume is every author's dream. I bet you guys are probably wondering, what sets this movie apart from other movies of the genre for you? Well, for one, it has the value of nostalgia for me as I used to watch it a lot, but I also have watched it with friends, so it has those nice memories attached to it. But most importantly, the movie has a lot of ideas from other genres that I do really like. If you haven't seen this movie, first of all, what rock have you been living under? But you'll see what I mean as the video goes on. Now this is a metafictional story, a story within a story, and the film is about a grandfather who visits his sick grandson to read him a book.
Hold it, hold it. What is this? Are you trying to trick me? Where's the sports? Is this a kissing book?
Now this kid... This is 10-year-old me watching this movie. Despite the grandson's initial reservations, the grandfather begins the story, which is set in the fictional land of Florin, and centres around a young woman named Buttercup. She lives on a farm and enjoys ordering the farmhand around, a young man named Wesley.
Farm boy, fill these with water. Please.
As you wish.
He only ever responds with that phrase, and one day Buttercup comes to realise that him responding in this way is his way of showing affection without having to say anything directly. As he has no money, he eventually leaves the farm to travel overseas and seek his fortune so that they can get married. Unfortunately, word travels that Wesley's ship was attacked by an ominous figure called the Dread Pirate Roberts, who is known to never take prisoners. Remember this guy's name, it'll come up later. 5 years pass, and Buttercup is betrothed to Humperdinck, Prince of Florin, who is also played by Chris Sarandon, Jerry Dandridge. She agrees to it, despite not loving him, and it's heavily suggested that Buttercup is just too depressed to want to argue about it. It's pretty sad when you think about it. Just before the wedding ceremony is supposed to occur, Buttercup is kidnapped by three criminals. A Sicilian named Vizzini, a giant Greenlander named Fezzik, and a Spanish fencing expert named Inigo Montoya. They plan on taking her to Gilda, the enemy land of Florin, and framing the Gildurians for Buttercup's kidnapping.
Once the horse reaches the castle, the fabric will make the prince suspect the Gildurians have abducted his love.
The story behind this becomes a bit complicated later on, but this is just what's important right now. Vizzini is shown to be pretty crafty but pretty mean, and Fezzik and Inigo are characterised as more honourable, and are just working for Vizzini out of poor circumstances. The men become distracted as they sail through water, overrun with the anthropophagous shrieking eels, because they notice that a boat is following them. Buttercup takes this opportunity to jump overboard in the hope of escaping, but Fezzik has to pull her out at the last minute before she is eaten by an eel. They are pursued by the mysterious ship to the Cliffs of Insanity, but a man wearing all black just scales the cliffside to reach Buttercup. The names are so ridiculous, only in a universe like this could things like shrieking eels and the Cliffs of Insanity exist and be taken seriously. Vizzini and Fezzik go on and leave Inigo, taking Buttercup with them, and Inigo is ordered to duel with the man and defeat him. Before they duel, Inigo allows the man to rest after scaling the cliff, and asks him if he has six fingers on his right hand. He doesn't. Inigo explains that he became such a skilled fencer in the hopes of avenging his father, a master sword maker that was killed by a six-fingered man. And now, we get one of the most iconic lines in cinematic history.
I will go up to the six-fingered man and say, "Hello. My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die."
Can you blame anyone? It's such a good line. I really love the fencing duel though. The man in black and Inigo clearly have a lot of respect for each other as swordsmen. And it sort of comes across as two people nerding about a mutual passion.
But I find that Tybalt cancels out Capoferro. Don't you?
Unless the enemy has a study, he's a gripper. Which I have.
While there is some tension, there's obviously no real animosity between the characters. And the fact that Inigo let the man rest before they fight, so that it's a more fair match, is very honourable. In return, when the man defeats Inigo, he doesn't kill him, but simply knocks him unconscious. Next, Fettini leaves Fezzik to battle the man in black, and the pair agree to put down their weapons and fight each other like men. The man has the advantage of being agile, and Fezzik has brute strength on his side, and the two idly chat while fighting, much like the previous battle.
Were you wearing a mask? Were you burned by acid or something like that?
Oh no, it's just they're terribly comfortable. I think everyone will be wearing them in the future.
Well, that line didn't age so well. Again, I really like this dynamic. As while Fezzik obviously has the upper hand here, he has a sense of integrity, and isn't really willing to just kill his opponent outright.
Are you just fiddling around with me or what?
I just want you to feel you're doing well. I hate for people to die on the hands.
The man knocks Fezzik unconscious by asphyxiating him, and continues following Fettini and Buttercup, who are now also being tracked by Humperdinck and his men. Fettini challenges the man to a battle of wits, where they both have to drink wine possibly laced with an undetectable poison named iocane powder. Fettini then delivers one of the most baffling monologues that I've ever seen.
Which means you must have studied, and in studying you must have learned that man is mortal, so you would have put the poison as far from yourself as possible, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
I don't think that you'd need to study to know that, but it all turns out to just be something to bamboozle the man, as Fettini then uses the "Oh my god, what is that?" cover from the Marty McFly school of tricking people to be able to switch the goblets around. The man wins anyways, both goblets were poisoned, and he has built up an immunity to iocane powder. While the man in black would obviously win, the method as to how is quite surprising upon a first time viewing, and all that subversion is really clever writing. Humperdinck continues tracking Buttercup, and the way he jumps on his horse here is so funny to me. Buttercup tells the man in black that she doesn't love the prince, and he confesses that he is the Dread Pirate Roberts. When he says he remembers killing her farm boy and questions whether she really cared for him due to her current engagement, Buttercup becomes angry and pushes the man into a ravine. As he falls down the cliffside, he repeats a familiar line.
"As you wish."
Oh, my sweet Wesley, what have I done?
While it was pretty clear to the audience that the man in black was Wesley, this was a nice way to reveal it to Buttercup, with a callback to something that was established several times at the beginning of the movie, and something that would be sentimental to both of them. Humperdinck and his men now closing in, Wesley and Buttercup journey into the deadly fire swamp. Here, Wesley explains that the Dread Pirate Roberts is an alias that is passed down to someone else when the previous Roberts wants to retire. The Roberts before him wasn't the real one either. Now, the fire swamp has three terrors: the fire spurts, the lightning sand, and the ROUSs.
Wesley, what about the ROUSs?
Rodents of unusual size? I don't think they exist.
This scene has always pissed me off. I get that some people just freeze when they get scared, but Jesus woman, that's your future husband! Grab his sword, bash its brains in properly, do something! Of course, Wesley defeats the rodent of unusual size, gaining a few injuries, but he and Buttercup are apprehended by Humperdinck's men once they've escaped. Humperdinck lies and says that he will allow Wesley to go back to his ship, and when his advisor, Count Rugen, captures him, Wesley notices that he has six fingers on his right hand. After having a nightmare about it, Buttercup threatens suicide if the wedding goes ahead, so Humperdinck lies again and says that he will send his four best ships to find Wesley. It turns out that Humperdinck was the one who hired Vizzini to capture Buttercup and blame Gilda as an excuse to go to war with them, but now he'll just kill her and blame them instead. A bit of a convoluted plan, right? Meanwhile, Rugen uses Wesley as a guinea pig for his new rack-inspired torture device, which sucks years of life off the victim. Humperdinck orders that the thieves' forest will be cleared for the wedding, and Fezzik joins the brute squad that will achieve this. He finds Inigo drunk and waiting for Vizzini, who of course, will never arrive. While sobering him up, Fezzik tells Inigo about Vizzini's death and that the six-fingered man is Count Rugen. As he defeated all three of their original group, a now alert Inigo figures that he needs the man in black's help in storming the castle, wherever he is. Realizing that Humperdinck lied about sending those ships, Buttercup calls him a coward, so in spite, the prince turns Rugen's torture device up to its highest setting, seemingly killing Wesley.
That is the sound of ultimate suffering. My heart made that sound when Rugen slaughtered my father. The man in black makes it now.
Now, while I do love this movie and can forgive it for this, this has always bothered me too. How would Inigo know this? At least the way that he finds the entrance to Rugen's torture chamber is explained by magic mumbo jumbo. Fezzik and Inigo take Wesley's body to Miracle Max, a miracle guy who just so happens to be played by Billy Crystal, aka Mike Wazowski? Small acting world, guys. Max says that he will only work for the amount they offer him if it's a noble cause, being grouchy as Humperdinck fired him, destroying his self-esteem, but he assesses that Wesley is only mostly dead. He refuses to accept that their cause is true love, though, but his wife Valerie intervenes.
Get back, witch!
I'm not a witch, I'm your wife! But after what you just said, I'm not even sure I want to be dead anymore!
You never had it so good.
You know, as a kid, I assumed my future marriage would be more like Wesley and Buttercup, but now this is how I picture it. According to interviews with the cast, this scene was very difficult to film because the actors kept corpsing as Billy Crystal and Carol Kane were too funny.
He gave us all hernias during the shoot because he didn't do any take the same way twice.
Look who knows so much, eh?
Rob just said, just go, Billy. Do your thing. And each take was so insane, I was supposed to be playing dead.
The couple give Fezzik and Inigo a miracle pill to revive Wesley, although he is very weak. The three of them storm the castle, and a panicked Humperdinck rushes through the wedding ceremony. Our heroes come across Rugen, who Inigo pursues, but is injured when Rugen throws a dagger at him and doesn't miss.
Oh, don't remove it. Yeah, adrenaline and all, but you're gonna bleed to death.
Despite his wound, Inigo overpowers and kills Rugen, because movie logic, and Wesley stops Buttercup from committing suicide, assuring that her vows were not binding as she didn't complete them. Humperdinck enters the room, but Wesley threatens to completely disfigure him aside from his ears, and utterly verbally destroys him.
So that every shriek of every child at seeing your hideousness will be yours to cherish. Every babe that weeps at your approach, every woman who cries out, "Dear God, what is that thing?" will echo in your perfect ears.
You're never gonna come back from that. The group allows Humperdinck to live and escape on horses. Wesley offers the Dread Pirate Roberts title to Inigo now that he's completed his life mission, and they all live happily ever after. Pleased with the story, the grandson asks his grandfather to read it to him the following day, and the grandfather gives him a rather fitting answer.
Maybe you could come over and read it again to me tomorrow.
As you wish.
This film is a lot of fun and is totally perfect to watch on Valentine's Day, and I hope that my video has been able to convey that well. The cast does an excellent job and each person suits their role so well. For years, I had no idea that Robin Wright, who plays Buttercup, was American. Her accent is pretty good.
The constant foreshadowing and self-references are very smart, and the use of metafiction is also great. As I said, it's pretty easy to identify with the grandson as a child, and the parts where they interrupt the story are never needlessly jarring or feel like an intrusion. Part of what makes me like this story so much is that it satirizes everything I dislike about the romance genre. It's a classic story with a hero that must save a princess, but it takes clichés from those stories and subverts your expectations. While smart and resourceful, Wesley isn't perfect and never completes the quest on his own. Another example is that characters like Fezzik could just be stupid fiends, but he's portrayed as sensitive and caring. Well, that's all for this video. So, do you agree with my opinion after watching my review? If not, what's your favourite romance movie? Let me know by leaving a comment down below. Be sure to follow me on social media as they are all linked in my description box. And as always, thanks for watching.
Something like a polo to ease my mind. With polos by my side, I'll always shine. The blue and green ones are my favorite kind. But I'll eat the colored ones from time to time. 'Cause polos is life, polos is life, polos is life.